Abby DiLorenz with Soul to Soul Wellness. My background is in athletic training, so the person who runs on the football field when someone gets hurt, that's what my background is in. From there, I went and got a master's degree in biomechanics, so the study of movement in the human body, the different forces, the torque that happens on the body, and how different movements impact your body as well. I began my company, Soul to Soul Wellness, a few years ago to help people move better. So I take my background in the physical therapy, athletic training world, and I have kind of combined it with the yoga to something that I call yoga rehab. So yoga rehabilitation, a little bit of pushing and pulling from me, manual therapy is what we call it. Combine it with the yoga, with the breath, with the meditation for a different, more holistic way to heal. Also with my company, I do a ton of continuing education stuff. So in the yoga world, I'm all around Nashville. I have a few things online. I have an ebook available for you online as well. If you like it, head over to my website. It's www.learnyogaanatomy.com. From there, I have some blogs up. Pardon me, I haven't blogged in a little bit. I'm about to get back into that, but there's some YouTube videos for you, as well as my Instagram page has a lot of free content that I hand out. Sign up for my email list and you will have access to all of that as well. My Instagram handle is Soul to Soul Wellness, SoulToSoule Wellness. But if you need anything, please feel free to reach out. I'll send along my contact information as well. So today I'm here to teach you about some cautions, some modifications to keep in mind as you begin a yoga practice and as you begin to move and feel your body move. I'm just going to share a few kind of tips and tricks with me that I've worked for my students, for me personally, as for some teachers that I have taught in the past. So to start, number one, listen to your body. It is your number one feedback system. As much as the teacher can be telling you something, if it doesn't feel good for you, don't do it. If it doesn't feel like you think it should, ask a question. We as teachers are here to help teach you. I don't know one single yoga teacher who has signed up to teach yoga to make money. It is here, we are here to help you. So with that being said, come to stand, feel your feet beneath you, and just listen to what happens, what turns on. Do you feel your weight shifting forward? Do you feel your weight shifting back? Can you feel your shoulders up to your ears? Can you squeeze your elbows together, shoulder blades together, and let your palms come to the front? And just listen, what does it feel like? From here, bring your pelvis up and in, squeeze your ribs together. So this is what we call true north. I'm sure your instructor will get into that today. But feel your feet. Do you feel your weight rocking forward? Do you feel your weight rocking back? You should feel your weight about midfoot. And just listen, is your hip talking to you? Is it saying, maybe rock some more weight towards me? Maybe rock some weight off of me. If you have any sort of pre-existing knee pain or shoulder pain, maybe your shoulders don't feel good when they're pulled up and open. Maybe you have some bicep, some pec, something going on in the front where it doesn't feel good to bring your palm to the front. Just notice that, what comes up for you? Number one, always listen to your body. Number two, listen to your instructor. They have over 200 hours of training, and over 20 of them has to be in anatomy. So listen to them. What are they telling you? Suck your belly up and in. Are they telling you to tuck your pelvis back under? Because if the teachers are giving you the cues, they hopefully see somebody doing that in class. And usually what somebody's doing on the mat next to you can be translated to your body as well. So listen to your instructor. Listen to the cues that they're giving to you. They'll be very purposeful. They should be very direct, and they will tell you exactly what to do. Number three, keep your core engaged. The core is the number one thing you need for every single yoga pose. You might hear your instructor say Mula Bandha or Uddiyana Bandha. These are just bond or locks that really just tell you to squeeze your core. So for example, if we come to chair pose, big toes together, heels apart, you're gonna sit your hips back. And a lot of the times what happens is we don't use our core here. So if the arms are up, arms are at our heart, it doesn't matter. But if you then bring your core in, you'll feel your belly kind of tuck in. They might say belly button to your spine or knit your ribs together. Mula Bandha will lift the pelvic floor up, Uddiyana Bandha will knit your ribs together. So by squeezing your lower ribs together, you should feel your core get nice and tight. By lifting your pelvic floor, you should feel your core get even tighter. Pull your belly button to your spine, you should feel everything nice and solid. And then translate this to every pose. So come out into a crescent lunge. It's the same thing. Lift the pelvic floor, knit the ribs together. Maybe you have to tuck your pelvis under just a little bit to feel the low belly engage. But regardless, you should feel all of this section in the middle, on your sides and your low back. Everything gets nice and tight and draws towards the midline. Almost like you have a corset on and you want to pull everything up. Think long spine, think everything knit to the middle. Number four, we want to have a natural arch in our low back. So with that being said, come back into our crescent lunge and notice that I do have an arch in my low back here. However, if my core is not turned on, I will have an excessive arch in my low back. You want to have a little bit of an arch just because that's natural. It's called our lumbar curve, but you don't want to dump into your low back. So come out into a warrior two. It's the same thing. You should have a little bit of an arch in your back, in your side body of your back leg. However, you don't want to dump into the front hip and really feel the back arch too much. Tuck the pelvis under, feel the belly engage, knit your ribs together. The arms can then come out from there. So it's not that you want to dump into your low back, but keep a little bit of a round spine. Another pose that this comes into handy with is a downward facing dog. So when you're in a down dog, you want to keep your knees bent and you want to create a little bit of an arch in your low back. From here, if your legs are straight and you're trying to get the hamstring flexibility, you might find that your back wants to arch because your hamstrings are too tight. Create a little bit of a bend in your knees, create a little bit of an arch in your low back, but the core is still engaged. Belly pulls up and in, and your ribs knit together. The next thing to help with this is just to know if you unlock your knees, you will flatten your spine. So if you have tight hamstrings and you come into a simple forward fold, with your legs straight, it's gonna pull on your pelvis posteriorly. So it just pulls your pelvis this way, which creates a really flat back. So when your legs are straight and you have this, it kind of makes your back arch. As soon as I bend my knees, my chest is able to come a little bit closer to my thighs. And not that I have a really big arch in my low back in a forward fold, but rather you are able to let your pelvis do what it wants to do. So same thing in our downward dog. You want to keep your knees bent just a little bit to create a little bit of an arch in your low back. And then from there, you can drop your heels towards the floor. For me personally, my knees stay bent in my practice for probably half of the practice. And from there, I start to drive my heels to the floor. Once I'm really good and warmed up, my hamstrings have some good blood flow there, my glutes, and my core is totally turned on with a little bit of extra blood. The heart gets pumping through your sun A's. And from there, you're able to straighten the legs as you get more into the longer holds, maybe into your hip opening or what have you. Number five is going to be rotation. Rotation occurs in your mid-spine. This is your T-spine. This is, if we're looking at our skeleton, in the middle of our back. It's all the way up by our shoulders to just underneath where our ribs stop. This is called our T-spine or our thoracic spine. So just know when you're coming into your chair twist and your crescent twist, as is in the JIP sequence, you're going to want to, number one, keep the core engaged, but number two, you should feel the rotation about your spine versus at your hips. So if I come into my chair twist, big toes together, heels apart, sit back in my chair. First thing I'm gonna do is kind of tuck my pelvis under a little bit. So a lot of people wanna come really into this low chair and they have this really big low back arch. I want you to come out just a little bit, tuck your pelvis under, find your core engagement. From there, hands come to your heart, it's a big inhale. On your exhale, you're gonna twist. So notice if my knees come out of alignment, if my knees come one in front of the other, you know the rotation is happening at your hips. So slide your hips back in line and you want to squeeze your shoulder blades together. That's called retraction. Squeeze your shoulder blades together, bring your gaze up to the sky, and you should feel more of the rotation in your mid-back versus at your hips or in your low back. So know that rotation occurs in your mid spine. Some things to help with this if you have some issues is if you come to a cat-cow position, so a quadruped four-legged position, take your hand behind your head. The inhale brings your elbow to your wrist and the exhale rotates to the sky. Notice if your hips want to do a lot of movement here. If they do, and if you have a hard time fighting it, sit back into your child's pose. Bring your elbow between your knees and then try your rotations here. So here you've kind of locked your hips into place and now most of the rotation can occur in your mid spine. Just a little simple trick to kind of help with that. Our last two things is going to be talking about mostly the upper extremity. So for our number six, I want to talk about the fingers. So if you look at the fingers, they're the same thing as your toes. They're even called the same thing in science. They're called their phalanges. So come all the way up to stand. You're going to come onto your toes, and I want you to notice all of your knuckles. So when you come up onto your toes, you should see that your knuckles at every single joint in your toe are doing something, and the pad of your toes are grounding into the ground. So maybe the pads of your toes are turning white, as in they're losing a little bit of blood flow because they're working so hard. That's the same thing with your fingers. So if you take your fingers to the mat, I want you to squeeze back onto your fingers. So place your fingers wide on your mat and then squeeze, lift up your second knuckle. So if you're here, you want to squeeze and lift your knuckles up to the ground so it looks kind of like that. So from there, we call this spider fingers. That will help create integrity in your wrist. It will help turn on all your wrist muscles. If you take your thumb and your index finger around one of your wrists and you make a fist, you should feel your wrist get big. If you make wide hands, you should feel your wrist get even bigger. So this is the importance of active fingers, where as we have active fingers, we are activating our wrists, we are strengthening our wrist muscles, we're strengthening our grip muscles. So find your spider fingers, so wide fingers, really a lot of integration there. Ground down through the pads of your fingers and then drag your pads closer to your palm and your knuckles should lift up. Anytime your hands are on the floor, you should have that much integration in your fingers, which leads us right into our last final topic, which is our vinyasa. So in a vinyasa-based class, such as Baptiste, you want to make sure your vinyasa is solid because that is something you're going to repeat a lot of times. And if something you repeat a lot of times has a lot of ailments or issues going on in it, you will then have more issues. So we want to make sure that we're bringing integrity into our vinyasa every single time. This also goes back to number one, listen to your body. Because when you get tired, your body will get tired and you'll start adapting, you'll start strengthening the wrong muscles, you'll start falling into some range of motion, diving into your joints, and that's never a good thing. That is not a successful yoga practice. A successful yoga practice looks like whatever you need when you show up to the mat that specific day. Some days you'll be tired. Some days you'll be hungry. Some days you'll be well rested and fed and you will feel like a warrior. Not all days. So just know that. Every day will be a little bit different. But with your vinyasa, I want you to think about bringing the index fingers towards the outside corners of your mat. So instead of bringing your index fingers to face each other, such as like a diamond push-up would be, you're going to bring your index fingers to face the outside corners of your mat. Your thumbs will then face almost if you were to draw a line, almost like a triangle or an A type position with the index fingers facing out. From here, I don't necessarily need you to bring the eye of your elbows or the inside line of your elbows out towards the front, but rather leave them facing each other. When you come into your vinyasa, you shouldn't squeeze your elbows to the middle. Notice how this doesn't look great, but rather right in line. So you should see your elbow in line with your shoulders, and you only want to drop as low as your shoulder is in line with your elbow. So when you come into your vinyasa, you're going to come from a high plank position. Again, you want your index fingers facing the outside corners of your mat. Ground down through the pad of your finger and pull the pad towards the palm. From here, find your high plank. You're gonna pull your belly up and in. It's the same thing we've been doing, talking about. Belly up and in, Mula Bandha, Uddiyana Bandha, everything nice and tight. Rock forward on your toes and lower halfway down. From here, you're gonna flip your toes. Your hands have not left the floor. They're still facing the outside corners of your mat. Ground down through your big toes, lift your thighs up. You wanna squeeze your shoulder blades together. This is external rotation in your shoulders, which with the index finger facing the outside, we're already helping this motion out. From here, belly pulls up and in, lead with your hips, press back, downward dog. Again, the knees are unlocked. You're pressing the floor away, index fingers towards the outside corners of your mat. This external rotation in your shoulders is there the whole time because we've set our index fingers towards the outside corners. So just some tips and tricks to help you guys as you begin your yoga journey. Please let me know what you need. I'm here for you. Again, my name is Gabby DeLorenz with Soul to Soul Wellness, and I look forward to seeing you on your mat. Thank you so much for your time, and enjoy.